The NFL is currently funding a lot of research related to pro football players, you know, and what we're finding is pro football players and even college football players who experienced several concussions throughout their career are now developing diseases later in life, like Alzheimer's disease and ALS. But going to play in a college arena or a professional arena is kind of rare. Most people will stop after high school. And, you know, concussions still can happen in early adulthood, you know, middle school football and high school football. In fact, they happen quite commonly. So my research is really answering the questions, what about the average Joe? You know, people who might have played high school ball going to have memory deficits or any brain changes related to concussions later in life? So, you know, that's the question that I hope to help answer as to, you know, what we need to do to protect people who are young in life from kind of growing and aging into a place where they are at a increased rate of getting Alzheimer's disease. And two concussions might be totally fine. We don't know, but at this point we're kind of cautious, and you know, I think the data needs to come in to start influencing policy. A lot of the types of scans that we're taking aren't used by doctors or hospitals. They're quite experimental, and it's really to try to figure out at a more basic science level what's going on in the brain of someone who's had previous concussions, in hopes that one day maybe doctors and you know, hospitals would use this technology. But it's just not there yet. So for us to give feedback to an individual person, it might be inaccurate, and it's better to look at it for everyone, kind of on the group and the study level at this point. And I don't know if you remember this, it was a very discreet time in my childhood where there were these little kind of collectible animals that were filled with sand, but then I would like catalog them, and I made like an index card file organization system for all of these sand animals. So that's like my first early nerd experience. For a long time, I wanted to be a doctor. I have an early memory of my mom had minor back surgery when I was about 3, and we had just gone to Disney World on a family vacation, and I had kind of the goofy hat on with like these long floppy ears and a Fisher-Price doctor's bag that had like a plastic stethoscope and a plastic knee reflex thing. So I was walking down the hall, and all of the nurses were pointing and laughing at me and calling me Dr. Goofy. And I've kind of adapted that persona. I'm someone who's very lighthearted and humor-filled and fun-loving, but also have this really serious kind of nerdy doctor side. And I wanted to be a doctor for a really long time, so I took all the pre-med courses. And I did well in the courses, but I didn't enjoy it, and I got involved in research that had a really cool clinical application. And as soon as I started doing research, I kind of settled like, oh, maybe I don't need to go into medicine and be a doctor when I can kind of discover new knowledge and publish studies on the things I'm most interested in. I feel like most people who are LGBT in the science community are somewhat under the radar. And I don't want that to be confused with not out. I have no doubt that they're out there. It's just less visible because it's physically less visible. You know, something like skin color is really easy to see, and something like sexual orientation or gender preference or gender identification isn't that visible. So I just feel like that, I don't necessarily know if it's under an underrepresented community. I think that's a really interesting question, but I definitely think it's more under the radar because you can be more under the radar. Overall, I would bet it's a little bit more liberal and kind of immune to these things that you might, you know, that someone who's different in any way, shape, or form might experience outside. A satisfying aspect of what I do, I think, is kind of hitting that final button, that click on the computer screen, and seeing that you've gotten brain results. You know, I think that's just like, you work so hard, sometimes for over a year, you know, finding people and enrolling them in the study and putting them through all of these different tests. And then even after they've come in, you still have hours and hours of work to do before you can kind of make some sort of conclusion, some final statement about what you're doing. And hitting that button where you're like gonna get the final bottom line on a study, I think is so fun. And to see the brain light up in certain regions and kind of say like, I had this hypothesis, based on all these other studies, but I did a completely new and different study, and for me to see exactly what I predicted 2 years ago is awesome. I loved that moment.